Episode number 248 of the Wholesome Fertility Podcast. My guest today is Nicole Kruck. Nicole has been practicing traditional medicine using an array of therapies for reproductive and women's health for over 26 years. She is a licensed Oriental medicine practitioner, acupuncturist, and massage therapist, providing a wide range of holistic treatments for gynecological conditions, pregnancy, fertility, IVF, ART support, digestive issues, along with other reproductive issues for women. Due to her own health concern in 1997, she helped forge the profession of professional practitioners of the Vrigo techniques of Maya abdominal massage, which treats abdominal and pelvic conditions for both men and women. Her unique dual certifications as both a licensed acupuncturist and licensed massage therapist provides exceptional results using both Eastern and Western proven medical treatments. Nicole also teaches acupuncture at SUNY Downstate Medical to medical doctors as well as other related women's health courses. Her private practice is located in New York City. Welcome to the Wholesome Fertility Podcast. I'm Michelle, a fertility acupuncturist here to provide you with resources on how to create a wholesome approach to your fertility journey. Welcome to the podcast, Nicole.
Thank you for having me today, Michelle.
I'm so excited to have a fellow acupuncturist on board and talking about also something that I'm very interested in, which is Mayan abdominal therapy. So before we get started, I'd love for you to introduce yourself and give us a bit about your background, how you got into this work.
Great. Well, my name is Nicole Kruck. I have a practice in New York City, Fertile Garden Wellness. And I got into the work first through massage therapy. I had been going to school and one of my colleagues had gone to a resort in Belize next to Dr. Rosita Arvigo's farm. And she went over there and started walking on this little medicine trail, and they had a little bookstore. And she came back so excited. She was like, I brought you this book. This woman is an amazing healer. And I see you, you know, working here and doing traditional work. And I'm like, yeah, sure. And she gave me this book called Sastoon, My Apprenticeship with a Maya Traditional Healer. And it was basically a bunch of little case studies of Dr. Rosita working with a traditional healer in Belize. He had been practiced. She met him when he was like 83, and he had been practicing since he was 16 years old. And she's originally a doctor of naturopathy, which is like a soft chiropractic out of Chicago, but she had been living in Central America for about 30 years. And when she moved to Belize, she had heard of this traditional healer and sought him out and met him and started apprenticing with him and other traditional healers and midwives in the area. So these little case studies were about all different things. And one of the case studies was about a woman who had a tipped uterus, who had a retroverted uterus, and who had always had like painful periods and wanted to conceive. And when I read this, I was like, oh my goodness, this is my story in this book. And when I was about 5 years old, I had fallen off a big slide onto a cement slab on my back. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was unconscious for a little bit, but, you know, didn't ever think anything about it. I was also a gymnast. And by the time I had my period, my first period around 13, it was painful. And it continued to be up until I found this work. What happened probably is that my uterus had wandered out of place. The ligaments had gotten overstretched. And so my uterus never had a chance to really have healthy periods to be able to empty out. And then it just caused all sorts of other things. I had painful intercourse. I was always getting, you know, yeast infections and different symptoms that matched what I was reading in this book. So at 37, I was like, oh my goodness, I have to find this woman. She was still living in Belize, but she started coming to the States doing herbal conferences. So I sought her out at a conference, along with several other women who had also, you know, had kind of heard of the 100th monkey, and were like, you have to teach us this information. And she's like, well, so anyhow, 6 months later, pretty much she came back and taught like the first self-care classes. And I was amazed. I learned how to do the 5 minute self-care massage on myself, which is one of the main things about that's different about this massage therapy is that we do work in the office, but we also teach our clients how to do a little, very gentle 5 minute massage at home that helps to keep the work moving, helps to get better circulation to the pelvis, to all the organs. And so I started doing that on myself for 5 minutes once a day. And after 30 days, it was the first time in my life that I didn't have a painful period. I was like, oh my gosh, from 13 to my 30s, I was like, how come nobody ever told me this? How come other people don't know about this? So it changed my life. And I felt like because I had learned this information that I had to pass it on to other people. And I've always been interested in traditional medicine and, you know, what I started doing Western herbs when I was younger and plants and, you know, crystals and all sorts of stuff. So it's always kind of been my calling, but to be able to add this on was amazing. And then later on in life, I was very interested in, you know, I'm 62 now. And so I was looking for-
You look great. You look great.
Thank you. I'm proud of it. I'm really proud of it now. But I was looking for a retirement career because I've been doing massage now for 26 years. And I love it. I love it dearly. And I'll start teaching more to kind of, you know, mentor other women and other practitioners. But I was like, what can I do that's a little bit more gentle? And I kept coming back to acupuncture because every time I'd go to my acupuncturist, they would fix my back. They would fix my, you know, sleep. They would fix my anxiety. They would fix, you know, all sorts of stuff. And when I went into menopause, like that was amazing because it was that wonderful hormonal switch that I needed to really, you know, kind of get me through it. So anyhow, you know, backing up, that's kind of how I got into the work and I love it. I mostly do like a lot of reproductive and fertility work, but I also do digestive elimination, incontinence, acid reflux, you know, back pain, all of it. But that's really my main focus because I really want to be able to educate people on how they can heal their own bodies, you know?
Yeah. And I think that's key is that people don't realize that they can heal their own bodies. I think that it's very similar to you. I never really knew about this growing up. And I had irregular periods really from 13 up until 25, really, really irregular, like 3 months we're talking. And I felt it other ways too. My circadian rhythm was off, like so many things. And I thought I had no solution because I just never found it. And I finally found it with Chinese medicine, but if you don't know, you don't know. And I think that that's the message really is that yes, your body is able to heal itself. And I think knowing that can be so empowering because a lot of people really don't know that. They don't get told that. They think that they have to depend on whatever has been discovered thus far. And that's that. But the body is self-healing. Even what we do is we get the body to a place where it can heal itself. So we don't really do the healing. Mm-hmm. It's the body. We just create an environment for the body to heal itself.
Yeah. And the thing is that, you know, living in the US, we kind of threw the baby out with the bathwater. You know, we don't have a lot of traditional medicine. We weren't raised on traditional medicine. Like our grandmothers probably talked about stuff and knew where the herbs were and, you know, they
keep your feet warm, all of that.
Right. All those things knew. That we thought were myths were really true, you know? Yeah. And so we don't have that education and nowhere do we really get it anymore. Whereas if we lived in a third world country or, you know, someplace like with still traditional medicine, it would be different. In places like that, they don't have access to doctors as much. They don't have access to, you know, pharmaceuticals and MRIs and all of that. So it's really the traditional medicine that's been used for thousands and thousands of years that can really help. So if I had fallen when I was five, I would have gone to the hospital, made sure I didn't have a concussion. And then, you know, the aunties or whoever would sweep me up and start doing the massage on me because, you know, your uterine ligaments are kind of set as of like, I don't know, I can't remember the exact number, but I would say like 3 years old. So, you know, when you have falls like that, if you address it right away,
right,
then you can heal those ligaments and keep them from overstretching. So a little uterus 101, would you like me to do that?
Absolutely.
Okay. So the uterus 101 that we should have gotten was our uterus has this amazing ability to go from like 4 ounces to like 15 pounds when we're pregnant and back down and back up again. And the reason it can do that is because there's 13 kind of hammock ligaments that support it in the front and the back and the top and the bottom. So as she expands, they kind of hold her off of the other structures as much as possible because the uterus is kind of sandwiched between the bladder and the front, kind of behind the pubic bone, and then behind the rectum and the large intestine. So everything kind of has their little sandwich place. But when the uterus, when what happens is when we have trauma, like, you know, a fall or a car accident, or we do a lot of strenuous aerobics where there's a lot of pounding with no rebound, you know, instead of like being on dirt or a trampoline, running, you know, running on hard cement in the city, there's no kind of recoil for those ligaments. So they overstretch and over time they just give out, like the ligaments in the elastic in your waistband, and your uterus can just kind of fall wherever that happens. So it could go forward onto your bladder. So a lot of times you feel like you have to pee more than other people, or, you know, you're always doing that just in case pee, or you can't hold your urine as much. Or it could be going back onto the intestines. And a lot of times you're going to feel that in your period, like close to your period, as your uterus is going from like 4 ounces to 6 to 8, that pressure on the rectum may cause more constipation or funny diarrhea or back pain, that type of stuff. And then besides the other organs, you have microscopic arteries, veins, nerves, lymphatics that are feeding the uterus and all those organs, like oxygenated blood and nutrients, and helping to move the hormones and the lymphatic system. So when the uterus shifts a little bit, it can sit on the organs, but also those vessels. So it's like when you're watering your plants and somebody steps on the hose, not all the water comes out. It's the same thing. So especially close to your period, right? When you have that extra weight on those vessels, that's when, you know, you're going to start to feel more inflammation and things are happening. The beauty about the massage is so simple. Basically, it's getting better circulation to the pelvis, which helps to bring nutritious blood into the area, which helps to strengthen those ligaments because we're also stretching them just a little bit. It's like doing little bicep curls to strengthen those ligaments so that it brings the uterus back into place. Because the round ligament goes from like 4 inches to like 16 when you're pregnant, and then back down in a month if everything's healthy. If it's not, you know, that's when you have problems. So those ligaments can heal very quickly, unlike the ones in your knee or shoulders, but they just need a little help. And that's what the massage does. And I've seen like so many kind of miraculous things happen, like, you know, like all of a sudden the lining gets better, or all of a sudden, you know, maybe before they weren't getting pregnant and the ovaries are getting more circulation. Maybe the tubes were had a little fluid or something. So as you're doing the massage in the pelvis, it's stretching the ligaments, it's getting that circulation going. And so people sometimes will have, you know, better outcomes with assisted cycles, especially with lining and painful periods go away, like overnight, like mine did. Sometimes it takes a while, but it helped to bring in more regulation. And that's why I love the massage part. I love being a massage practitioner, but I also love being acupuncturist because massage physically can go in and break up adhesions and scar tissue. We think about, you know, things like appendectomies, especially when we were kids, or I've had people that had like hernia surgeries when they were like 5 years old, right? That compromise those tissues, or, you know, a lot of people have had intestinal surgeries and C-sections and all of that, and it never got addressed. And that anytime you go in and you break open those tissues, it creates scar tissue. And so that kind of binds things down. I think of scar tissue as like, if you made a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, right? When you first make it, you see the bread, you see the peanut butter, you see the jelly, you see the bread, and you see like all these layers, right? And you have to imagine that those vessels, the, you know, arteries, veins, nerves, and lymphatic vessels are going through there, and everything's healthy because it can all move. But if someone comes along and they sit on your sandwich, right? You can't kind of make out the jelly or the peanut butter or the bread, you know? So that's what massage does, is it helps to open up those tissues so that everything can move freely.
That is so interesting. And I definitely often suggest to do abdominal massage, but I know that this is a particularly effective technique that's unique. Can you explain it, I guess, in some terms? I mean, you had mentioned stretching out the ligaments. What does it feel like? And what do you usually do with this type of massage?
So if a client comes to me, we do, just like in Eastern medicine, we do a whole intake, talk about Western medicine that they're on or history, but then we also find out like, what's their lifestyle like? You know, are they sleeping? Are they eating? Have they had any falls? Were they on, you know, are they very athletic? Were they athletic when they were younger? Because most people don't realize a lot of this stuff happened when they were really young.
Yeah.
We're on our bikes, we're skiing, skating, you know, falling out of trees, cheerleading. And we never like put the two together.
Right.
So, you know, those are some of the really big keys. So when someone comes in, we do a really big intake. And then I get them on the table. I do some massage work, kind of see what's going on. The main thing I want to see is, where is their uterus at? So I can feel the top of the uterus, the fundus, through the abdomen to see if it's antiverted, retroverted. So the top of the uterus, the fundus, and that's what I'm feeling. And the bottom of the uterus is the cervix. And then you have the vaginal canal. So when the uterus is in place, the cervix points down towards the ground so that when you get your period, the cervix opens, the lining sloughs off with gravity. However, if the uterus shifts in any way, and then a lot of times what happens is the blood has to come first up against gravity and then come out because the cervix is in alignment.
Right.
So sometimes that's why sometimes you can see stuff like
old blood, right?
Yeah. That brown blood. If it's at the beginning, it can be the last period not cleaning out. If it's at the end, it can be from the period not cleaning out for a really long time. So that's why it's so important to get the uterus in place. And a lot of times that's something that Western medicine just bypasses because they can do an IVF. It doesn't really matter to them.
Right. But
you could, if you can strengthen those ligaments to get the uterus in place so that that lining can really come out, it can get that really good circulation, it makes a huge difference.
I bet. And just to kind of mention it to people listening, if you do have old blood, doesn't necessarily mean that it's because of this. It could be other reasons as well. Just kind of like, don't self-diagnose. But it's very interesting how important that is and how missed it can be as well. It's not something that a lot of people would think to look into. And of course, Western medicine, Eastern medicine, everybody has a different perspective and they look for different things. But most of the time, that is not something like the way your uterus is tilted, unless it's extreme, it's not really looked at in Western medicine.
Yeah, for sure. And I found like for me, I had a retroverted uterus. And when I started doing the massage, it really shifted.
So I remember speaking to the founder. I had her on the podcast. Well, she didn't come on because I was using some kind of software where you couldn't just get off right after. It needed to process and then it didn't. And then I wasn't able to reschedule with her. And also the, I guess where she was staying in Belize, is that where she is? I think the internet wasn't great and it was like this whole thing. So I wasn't able to get her back on. But I do remember her talking about vaginal steaming as well. And that's something that I've always been intrigued by. I've never suggested it per se. It's not something that I've looked, it's not because I'm against it. It's just because I don't know as much about it. Mm-hmm. But talk to us about that, because I do hear a lot of amazing things about vaginal steaming, actually.
Yeah, so vaginal steams have been around for centuries. If you go to Cozumel in the center of the island is San Gervasio, and that's the temple of Ixchel, who is the goddess of Maya goddess of healing and fertility and weaving. But anyhow, it's a uterine lavage and it's very gentle. What we do is we basically make up a pot of tea, and you can use anything as simple as, you know, any of the Italian herbs that are like antimicrobial, antifungal, antibacterial. So you have oregano, basil, rosemary. Those are all great herbs. You can use them in combination, and definitely mugwort, which we use in Chinese medicine because it's warming and it has this beautiful property to help healing with women. So you basically make up a pot of tea, and you can use a basic bench and put it underneath you, tent yourself up. And it's not like having a facial where you've got this constant heat coming towards you that's really intense. It's really kind of more warm and rolling. And what happens is that the oils, the essential oils from the plant. So we never use essential oils. It's too strong. We use the whole plant. So the essential oils carried up in with the steam into the vaginal canal and into the uterine lining. And so what it does is, like, really basic is it just helps to warm the uterus to bring better circulation to the area. But, you know, the plants can also help. Sometimes I might throw in like some calendula if someone's having some like vaginal irritation. There's all different kind of herbs that you can do. Always want to use organic. You don't want anything that's sprayed. But you basically sit for a few minutes and it's really relaxing. I have my women sometimes can just do it at home, clean out the toilet really well, get a bowl or pot that goes over the water line so that the water doesn't come into the bowl. You don't want like a big soup pot because you want a good 12 inches or so between you and the steam. But anyhow, it's really wonderful for, it can be great for fertility, especially if you're one of those people that your acupuncturist says, oh, you have a cold uterus. Like you actually put your hands on your uterus and it feels cold all the time. It is, I would do it usually at the beginning or the end of a period. If someone's having like a lot of brown blood, or, you know, there's like that spotting for a couple of days, but the period's not quite coming and they know they're not pregnant, I would do it. I wouldn't do it when I was pregnant, you know, if there was any chance that you could be pregnant, but that's kind of, it helps to move it's a blood mover in Chinese medicine. So it's a great.
Similar to castor oil.
Castor oil, I love. Castor oil is one of like my holy trinities. Castor oil packs is a purgative. So if you took it internally, you'd have like a huge bowel movement because it really purges stuff. If you use it externally with some heat, when I say heat, I want to say warmth. You don't want to like really move the blood, but you want to be able to open up the pores as much as possible for the oil to get in. And the best way to do it is to put it on a rag. So you want to use like anything that's 100% cotton or wool. And, you know, if it's like a hand towel and it's really thick, you only need one layer. But if you use like an old t-shirt or a sheet or something, you want to get about 4 layers so you can get a lot of oil into it. And you just make it as big as you want to do. If you want to do it over your uterus, it's great for if you're one of those people that gets ovarian cysts a lot, it's really good, or breast cysts, fibrotic breast. What it does is the heat, the warmth helps to open up the pores for the oil to go in, and it helps to bring circulation to the area. It helps to break up any adhesions, scar tissue. It's really nourishing for all the organs, ligaments, tissues. So, and it moves inflammation through the lymphatic system. So it's really great. However, the big caveat that I see is like, if you're trying to conceive that month, there's a very small window and it's kind of not even worth it. It's
right.
A great
it's thing. Before ovulation, right?
Yeah. But if you're trying to develop follicles, then you kind of don't want to like be purging any follicles. So mm-hmm. I would use it like before when you're, you know, when we say to try and conceive, you want to start at least, you know, 3-6 months a year in advance, that's when you want to be doing it. you know, or if you're taking a month off between cycles, say you did a retrieval and you're getting ready to do a transfer next month, then, you know, great, go for it. You can do it a couple of times a week. Worst thing that usually happens is, you know, people have a more bowel movements or something, but it's not like drinking it internally, but it's a really, they call it Palm of Christi, the Palm of Christ, because supposedly it can help, you know, heal anything.
Amazing. And then for the abdominal massage, what conditions or what have you seen? Have you seen it help fibroids? Like how?
Yeah.
Because I know that there are some conditions that are more difficult to treat.
Yeah. I mean, it definitely can help fibroids. You know, if you've got, you know, things over 5 millimeters and I would even say even 3, you know, it's not going to get rid of them. I mean, it may help, you know, it may help to kind of deter them from growing, which is great, especially if you're one of those people that doesn't want to have surgery. But especially if you're going to have surgery, say you do have bigger ones, or, you know, you want to have surgery before you try and get pregnant, then I would be doing castor oil packs before to kind of soften those tissues and break up, you know, things around so that it's much easier for them to do surgery. Ashermans. Oh my gosh. I work a lot with Ashermans and I had one woman whose uterus was basically, you know,
so for people who don't know what that is, yeah. It's adhesions. It's kind of like adhesion from scar tissues. It's usually like after having another condition that causes it.
Yeah. Sometimes with DNCs, you know, like a DNC that was very aggressive or an infection from something like that. That's where you're sitting on the peanut butter and jelly sandwich, where you can't, right. You know, it's not open. And especially if you're trying to conceive, like you really do need to do surgery, but a lot of times it closes up again. So I've had really good success with doing the massage to keep that uterus open, especially if someone's trying to conceive. Definitely painful periods and, you know, scar tissue from C-sections and tipped uteruses,
inflammation,
yeah,
bacterial infections.
Yeah. People who have had, like, you know, BV before and yeah, it's, and the thing about it doesn't have any bad side effects. Like if you just want to do the massage, great. But if say you're trying to conceive and you're worried, you know, if you're doing it at the right time, so you can do all of them, it's a whole abdominal massage, but you can do the whole massage up until you ovulate or you're trying to conceive that much if you're working with your fertility, but the whole upper abdomen you can still do because you still want to get that circulation to the pelvis. But in the pelvis, we just do kind of warm hands. And what we're doing is we're really opening up the upper abdomen because coming through, you know, coming from the heart is a major artery that's coming down through the abdomen to feed the pelvis and the rest of the organs. So you want to keep that roadway clear. And that's kind of what the massage does. It opens up to the roadway so there's not a lot of blockages so you can get that optimal circulation to your pelvis and then back.
Amazing. And then also right before retrievals, I know that there's always a fear of ovarian torsion. Like, so that's kind of something that I was wondering, do you guys have like a certain time limit before that?
I think it's great because a lot of times there's a lot of inflammation in the pelvis from all of the, and the whole abdomen from the injectables. So it really helps to move that circulation. So I've seen women who haven't seen me that have had torsions, but in 26 years, I've never had anybody have a torsion with me.
Okay. With a massage. So you will still go up until retrieval?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, it makes sense. You get more blood flow to the area.
Yeah. And people just feel better because, you know, they're getting injected and, you know, and it's emotional, you know, for the rebound from the hormones and everything else, they're kind of like a little over fried. So the massage itself is really good to be touched really gently and relaxed, and also to help move the inflammation for the bloating and some of the tenderness. People are really happy with the massage.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds very relaxing, and really having a massage on your abdomen really relaxes your body, like really relaxes your nervous system.
Yeah. And most people have never had abdominal massage. So, you know, you get your arms, your legs, your backs, your head, but, you know, that circulation is kind of stopping in that area. So once you start moving that, you get better circulation throughout the rest of the body as well. And I think as massage therapists, like, we were never trained, you know, we did like how to, you know, the circular thing to eliminate, you know, constipation, but that was it. It's kind of like, because, you know, we can hold a lot of emotion in our abdomens. And so a lot of people are not used to, it can be very exposing to people, or I don't want to use the word exposed, but
vulnerable.
Thank you. Yeah. That's exactly the word. So, you know, that's why I'm really gentle with people. It's always like, this is about you. There's nothing that I have to do or not do. You know, if you don't want me somewhere, you let me know. And I really help to get them breathing, because when you're breathing into the abdomen, that's what's really moving stuff. So it's not like it's a deep tissue and I'm really like, you know, jamming anything, you know, or it's not painful for most people. There's some, you know, if there's a lot of scar tissue or something, we are really gentle, you know, less is more. I'm really gentle about the work and it's very powerful.
I bet. And when you do that, do you usually do it before or after acupuncture?
A lot of times I'll do massage first and then do acupuncture. Because I'm a massage therapist and acupuncturist, people will come to me sometimes for one or the other, because sometimes they don't like needles or they don't like massage, which is totally fine. But one of the things that I like to do is to do both if people are open to it. So, you know, we'll do more massage at the beginning of the cycle and then kind of go more into acupuncture towards after ovulation if someone's trying that month. I'll do some massage first and then end with some acupuncture.
That sounds lovely. And how long is abdominal massage?
Well, normally I'll do like a 2-hour initial with someone. And so we'll do the whole intake. I'll see what I can do for them, other things that I can suggest. And then we'll do some massage. I always teach my patients in the first session, like, how to do their own self-care massage. I'll send them home with, you know, videos and everything else. And then any of the follow-ups are usually an hour.
No, but how long does the abdominal massage take?
Oh, in a session?
Yeah.
I can do a whole hour for sure.
Oh, just on the abdomen.
There's mostly the abdomen piece, but there's also like the back piece too. Cause when the body's out of alignment, that can also hold the uterus out of place. And, you know, there's also like a lot of scar tissue and adhesions I find on the sacrum. Most people have fallen, the coccyx bone is out, and, you know, just along the spine to that innervation to help the pelvis as well.
It sounds so great. It sounds great to have both massage and really get hands-on. Cause I feel like if you do, you're more in tune also with a person's energy by the time you do the acupuncture. So it sounds so relaxing just to hear about.
Yeah. And also if it's in the right time in their cycle, if someone's open to it, I will also do, you know, a vaginal steam, like that's included in the session if it's in the right time frame.
Awesome. So for people who are listening and they're like, oh my God, I want to do this. How can they find you? Especially people in New York that can come in person.
Yeah. So I do in person. I'm in Greenwich Village in New York City. I also do telehealth too, if anybody's interested. My company is Fertile Garden Wellness. My Instagram is Fertile Garden Wellness. And yeah, you can reach out to me that way. You can find me online. And yeah.
Sounds amazing. Well, you have such a nurturing energy about you. And I love that you're hands-on with the acupuncture, because I do feel like that brings a whole other element to the healing. And you're just lovely to talk to. And I'm so happy to have met you. And thank you so much for coming on today.
Oh, thank you so much. And I love your podcast and I love all that you share. You are so generous and you really do such a beautiful job. And I encourage everybody to listen to of your work, because it's amazing. So thanks for having me. I'm really honored.
So that concludes today's episode. You can find all of the links mentioned on the episode notes. If you're enjoying these episodes, please take a moment to share and leave a review. Reviews mean everything to podcasters, and I really enjoy hearing from my listeners. You can also find me on my website at www.thewholesomelotus.com or email me at info@thewholesomelotus.com. I love hearing from my listeners. If you're interested and want updates as well as a free ebook on my top 10 fertility boosting habits, you can visit my fertility page on www.thewholesomelotus.com. I thank you so much for listening in and hope that you have a beautiful day.